Hi, I'm Amy Goodman. In this critical election year, you count on Democracy Now! To stay focused on the stories that matter most. And we count on you to support our independent journalism. If everyone who tunes into Democracy Now! Signed up for a monthly donation of, say, just $6, we could cover our operating costs for the entire year. Really, that's all it would take. Please do your part today by visiting us at democracynow.org. Stay safe. Wear a mask, save lives. And thank you so much. From New York, this is Democracy Now!
I think we're seeing the convergence of a class rebellion with racism and racial terrorism at the center of it. In many ways, we are in uncharted territory in the United States.
As President Trump and Joe Biden face off tonight in the first presidential debate, we speak to Princeton professor Kianga Yamata-Taylor about the multiple crises facing the United States today, including the pandemic, police brutality and racism, mass unemployment, and the battle over the Supreme Court. Plus, we speak to Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter David K. Johnston on the bombshell report that President Trump did not pay any federal income tax in 10 of the past 15 years. In 2016, he paid just $750.
The New York Times expose about Donald Trump's income, his taxes, and his debts shows a lot more about why, for years, I've been saying Donald Trump is not a businessman. He's a criminal, a cash extractor. And what does that mean to you? A lot.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The global death toll from COVID-19 has topped 1 million, but the World Health Organization says the actual toll is likely far higher. In the United States, more than 205,000 people have died, and over 7.1 million cases have been reported, by far the highest figures in the world. More than half of all reported COVID-19 deaths have occurred in just four countries: the United States, Brazil, India, and Mexico. On Monday, India became the second country to top 6 million cases. Public health officials in the United States are expressing alarm as 21 states report a rising number of new COVID cases. Hospitalizations are surging in the Midwest. In the Dakotas, more than a quarter of all COVID-19 tests are coming back positive, the highest rate in the United States. Meanwhile, the New York Times is reporting top White House officials pressured the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention to downplay the risks of sending children back to school. The pressure campaign was confirmed by Olivia Troy, who served as Vice President Mike Pence's lead staffer on the task force till July. Meanwhile, NBC is reporting the head of the CDC, Dr. Robert Redfield, was overheard on a recent flight disparaging Trump's new coronavirus advisor, Dr. Scott Atlas, saying, quote, "everything he says is false," unquote. Atlas has faced widespread criticism from public health specialists for questioning mask use and promoting a controversial herd immunity strategy that could lead to the deaths of millions of Americans. Atlas is a neuroradiologist with no background in epidemiology. Meanwhile, another immigrant has died in ICE custody, becoming the 21st this year, the highest death toll since 2005. He died from coronavirus. In other news, the nation's largest nurses union, National Nurses United, has criticized federal and state governments for failing to protect medical workers during the pandemic. At least 1,700 healthcare workers, including at least 213 registered nurses, have died from COVID-19. Kentucky's Attorney General Daniel Cameron agreed Monday to release the recording of grand jury proceedings in Breonna Taylor's case to the court on Wednesday. A judge ordered the release, but it's not yet clear whether the tape will be made public. Earlier on Monday, an anonymous grand juror sued in order to unseal the court transcripts, accusing Daniel Cameron of using the grand jury, quote, as a shield to deflect accountability and responsibility for those decisions, unquote. The The juror also said jury members should be granted the right to speak freely about the case and be allowed to share, quote, any potential charges and defendants presented or not presented, unquote. This all comes as Vice News revealed interviews with Louisville SWAT team members show they raised concerns with the deadly raid that killed Breonna Taylor on March 13th, both before and after it happened. On Monday, fired Detective Brett Hankison pleaded not guilty to three counts of wanton endangerment for shooting into the walls of Breonna Taylor's neighbor. He and the other officers involved in her death have not been charged for killing Breonna Taylor after raiding her home. In Maryland, the family of a black man killed in January by police while handcuffed in a police car reached a $20 million settlement Monday. The settlement's believed to be one of the largest ever for a police killing. 43-year-old William Green was shot six times. Police said there was a struggle, but investigators found no evidence to substantiate the claim. Michael Owen Jr., the black police officer who shot Green, has been charged with second-degree murder. Green's daughter said at a Monday news conference some of the money would go towards combating police brutality. Green's cousin said of the settlement, quote, this doesn't bring justice, this doesn't bring peace. President Trump and Joe Biden are facing off tonight in Cleveland, Ohio, for the first of three presidential debates. Trump's expected to face questions about the bombshell report in the New York Times that revealed he paid no federal income tax in 10 of the last 15 years and just $750 in 2016 and 17. In a follow-up report, the New York Times reveals Trump made $427 million in connection with the hit reality TV show The Apprentice, providing him a financial lifeline as other investments lost money. The Times reports, quote, Mr. Trump's genius, it turned out, wasn't running a company. It was making himself famous, Trump-scale famous, and monetizing that fame. To hear or watch that presidential debate tonight at 9 Eastern Standard Time, you can go to democracynow.org. An investigation by Channel 4 News in Britain has revealed the Trump campaign actively sought to deter 3.5 million African-American voters in battleground states from voting for Hillary Clinton in 2016 by targeting them with anti-Clinton ads on Facebook. The network obtained a leaked copy of an election database used by the Trump campaign and the data from Cambridge Analytica that contained detailed records of nearly 200 million Americans. Many African-Americans were categorized in a group labeled deterrence. In London, Chinese dissident artist and filmmaker Ai Weiwei staged a protest Monday in support of WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange in front of the courthouse where Assange's extradition hearing is ongoing.
Someone threatened to be put away of his own, simply of his own, thinking under his peaceful demonstration. So, and he's such a genius in that way. And I think the fight is part of his life. And of course, I am here in supporting him.
Assange faces almost certain conviction if extradited to the United States and up to 175 years in prison. Julian Assange has been charged under the Espionage Act. U.S. prosecutors allege he conspired with whistleblower Chelsea Manning to illegally download hundreds of thousands of war logs from Iraq and Afghanistan, along with a huge trove of classified cables from the State Department. In other news from Britain, a court ruled Monday Uber can keep operating in London after regulators last year refused to renew Uber's license after it found some drivers were operating illegally. Uber has around 45,000 London-based drivers. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo has threatened to close the U.S. embassy in Baghdad unless Iraqi forces can prevent rocket attacks on U.S. targets. Several sources say the U.S. is already preparing to withdraw diplomats from Baghdad. Iraqi officials are calling on all parties to avoid an escalation over fears such a move by the United States could be a precursor to conflict with Iran, which the U.S. blames for the attacks. On Monday, the Iraqi army said a rocket fired at Baghdad airport, where U.S. troops are stationed, missed its target and killed five civilians, three Iraqi children and two women, all from the same family. The United States is ramping up pressure on Sudan to become the next country to normalize relations with Israel, but negotiations have reportedly stalled over the amount of financial incentive involved in a potential deal. The agreement hinges in part on the Trump administration removing Sudan from the U.S. list of state sponsors of terrorism, which could happen before Election Day. The United Arab Emirates and Bahrain both signed U.S. brokered agreements to normalize relations with Israel earlier this month at the White House. In defiance of international pressure, Chinese President Xi Jinping has defended China's policies targeting Uyghurs and other Muslim communities in the province of Xinjiang. On Saturday, Xi said the policy has been completely correct. There have been widespread reports of surveillance, forced labor, imprisonment, cultural repression, as well as forced sterilizations and child separations of Muslim populations in Xinjiang. A new report from the New York Times reveals thousands of religious Muslim sites in Xinjiang, including mosques, have been destroyed in recent years. On Friday, a meeting of the United Nations Human Rights Council in Geneva, Switzerland, raised the alarm over China's actions in Xinjiang, as well as their assault on human rights in Hong Kong. A Uyghur activist whose family is in China spoke at the gathering.
My family is held hostage in Chinese concentration camp. My brother is forced to assemble phone chargers as a slave labor. Your charger may be among them. 3 million Uyghurs being detained in concentration camps. Imagine the population of Berlin or Chicago locked up as slaves.
Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross said Monday, census counting will end next week on October 5th. In defiance of a federal judge's ruling last week, which said census operations should carry on as previously planned through the end of October. The Trump administration last month moved forward the deadline by 1 month to September 30th. On Monday, the California judge overseeing the case said she was, quote, disturbed by Ross's announcement and ordered the government to respond by today with its justification for shortening the census count. In California, at least 3 people are killed, tens of thousands forced to evacuate as wildfires continue to rip through Napa, Sonoma, and Shasta counties. Governor Gavin Newsom declared a state of emergency Monday, warning the Zog fire, which has burned over 30,000 acres since Sunday, could converge with the nearby August Complex fire, the largest in California's history. In a victory for Native American voting rights, a Montana court has abolished a state law that imposed severe restrictions on ballot collection in rural indigenous communities. The law limited the number of ballots one person could collect and restricted who was allowed to collect ballots. In Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, a top election official warned a loophole in a recent state Supreme Court ruling could cause as many as 100,000 mail-in ballots to be rejected statewide. The ruling concerns the issue of so-called naked ballots, ballots which could be rejected by poll workers if they are not received without a second secrecy envelope. Trump won Pennsylvania by only 44,000 votes in 2016. Meanwhile, in New York City, a large number of voters in Brooklyn said they received absentee ballots with the wrong name and address on the return envelope. In other election news, Trump's former campaign manager, Brad Parscale, has been arrested and involuntarily hospitalized for a mental health evaluation in Florida after his wife told police he might be suicidal and that he had hit her. Police seized 10 firearms from his property. Parscale was replaced as Trump's campaign manager in July and has been his digital strategist. And New York's parole board has granted the release of former Black Panther Jahlil Muntakim after he served nearly half a century in prison for the 1971 killing of 2 New York City police officers. 68-year-old Muntakim became infected with COVID-19 in May. Under the terms of his parole, he must be released by October 20th. The group Release Aging People in Prison, or RAP, said in a statement, Muntakim is, quote, one of thousands of incarcerated older people in New York State who is repeatedly denied parole despite his excellent record. Let us hope that his release brings inspiration for more change, they wrote. In a 2018 interview, Muntakim told filmmaker Messiah Rhodes what gives him hope.
New generation makes me extremely hopeful. We're finding that young people are now stepping up. What I see in many respects is what was happening back in the 60s, you know. evolving out of the civil rights movement, where you see that level of resistance.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by my co-host Juan Gonzalez in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, President Donald Trump and Democratic challenger, former Vice President Joe Biden, will face off tonight in Ohio in the first of three presidential debates. Host Chris Wallace of Fox News says the 90-minute showdown will focus on both candidates' records, the Supreme Court, coronavirus, the economy, race, and the integrity of the election. Each topic presents a pressure point in an unprecedented election season. Just 5 weeks before November 3rd, the global coronavirus death toll has topped 1 million worldwide. The virus continues to devastate African Americans, Latinx, and indigenous communities across the United States. As the economic crisis sparked by the pandemic shows no sign of abating, a wave of evictions looms. And more than 4 months after the police killing of George Floyd, protests are continuing against police brutality and in defense of Black lives. Just last week, people poured into the streets in protest after a grand jury failed to charge any of the white police officers who shot and killed Breonna Taylor in her own home with her death. The presidential debate comes as more than 1 million Americans have already cast their votes, and millions more are being urged to vote early to ensure their ballots are counted amidst unprecedented attacks on the democratic process by President Trump and his administration. This comes as Senate Republicans are racing to confirm right-wing Judge Amy Coney Barrett to fill Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg's seat on the Supreme Court. For more, we're joined by historian Kianga Yamata Taylor, contributing writer at The New Yorker magazine, where her latest column is The Case for Ending the Supreme Court as We Know It. She's also the author of several books, including Race for Profit, How Banks and the Real Estate Industry Undermined Black Home Ownership, which was a 2020 finalist for the Pulitzer Prize for History. She's joining us from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Professor Yamata Kianga Taylor, thank you so much. Professor Kianga Yamata Taylor, thank you so much for joining us. Let's start with this latest piece in The New Yorker. The headline of it is The Case for Abolishing the Supreme Court as We Know It. Can you tell the history of the Supreme Court and why you believe this?
Hi, Amy. Thanks for having me on. I think that the history of the Supreme Court has been one of really enforcing a conservative social order in the United States for most of its history. And in the moments, you know, in the 20th century, during the when Chief Justice Earl Warren presided over the court, so really from the late 1950s through the late 1960s, is this moment of the Supreme Court defending freedom and rights and all of these things really is an outlier in the court's history. And even within those instances, it has come at tremendous pressure from either social movements or shifting international political dynamics, where the United States needed to project itself as a beacon of democracy and really cover up and hide what was happening to African Americans in the South. And so I think that the court and the other wings of government always sort of defend the court as an apolitical body that is sort of neutrally making decisions about legal cases based on legal precedent and all of this really nonsense. The court is very much a political body. And now with Trump on the verge of being able to place an absolute reactionary justice on this court, giving it a 6-3 balance, or imbalance led by conservatives, the political nature of the court, both in the process by which this is happening and also by the potential of what these the way that this kind of court's decisions may reverberate. I think remove any illusion that the Supreme Court is anything but a political body doing the work of the right in a very undemocratic, authoritarian way. In any society, I think, that purports to describe itself as a democracy cannot have nine unelected people or even an expanded court of 13 unelected people or 15 unelected people making such consequential and categorical decisions that impact the lives of millions of people. Type of system, this type of institution, I think, has no place in a democracy.
Well, but Professor Taylor, part of the, I guess, the reasoning for the establishment of a Supreme Court, not only in this country, but in many countries around the world, is to check the powers of an executive branch or even of a legislative branch. How would you envision because obviously the power that the court currently has would then somehow or other devolve to other sections of government and leaving people open possibly to even more demagogic leaders than President Trump. Because remember, there's still 40% of the American people that back him no matter what he does. So how would you envision a change that would move more in the direction of democracy rather than in the direction of a demagogic influence or more authoritarianism?
Well, first of all, I would say that that is sort of, in some ways, that is representative of how the court has been working. In my article, I looked through a series of actions and cases throughout the 19th century. We're far from being a check on a slide towards undemocratic rule by state and federal legislatures. The Supreme Court merely reflected what was happening within those bodies. And I think now when we look at the way that Trump has been able to circumvent more lengthy and potentially problematic legislative courses, that he has simply appealed cases to the Supreme Court in expectation that he will have a favorable ruling. He has said in the last several days that his hope is that if there is a contested election, that the Supreme Court, whom he has handpicked, the last two and now potentially third justice, will make the determination. And so I think that we've already slid down that slippery slope into a body that hardly serves as a check, but is simply reflecting the sort of political imbalances that already exist. In terms of what should replace it, I think that that is up for a public discussion. I mean, part of the intent of my article was to say that we are in the midst of a national reckoning about systemic racism in this country, about the way that things are governed, the way that this country functions, that there are all sorts of things being thrown up for question that at one point or another have been assumed to be the natural order of things, from a for-profit healthcare system, which has now been thrown into question, to something even like the Sanders campaign and someone openly identifying as a socialist or a democratic socialist garnering millions of votes. To me, that is reflective of people wanting to rethink basic assumptions about what American society should look like. And I think in this case, things like the Supreme Court, the Electoral College, all are open for debate and discussion as we are talking about what our country looks like, what it could look like, what it should look like. How do we have more democracy, more voices of ordinary people dictating the course of things? To me, that is what is at the heart of some of the demands of the demonstrations that have been going on over the summer and now into the fall, is that the status quo is no longer working. And now is a time to throw it all open for discussion, throw it all open for debate. This is an opportunity to be rethinking what kind of society that we want to live in.
But in essence, isn't the growing right wing and fascist movement in the country also seeking to rethink and refashion the kind of country that we are? And in effect, are practicing some of that under Donald Trump. So how do you see putting together the kind of coalition that could actually structurally change the nature of American society to be able to implement some of the changes that you're hoping for, given the reality that there is this intransigent and substantial group of Americans who support the current move toward more authoritarianism?
Well, it's a struggle. It's not a cakewalk. And so, you know, the country right now is deeply polarized. But I think that I would probably I don't think that it's polarized and that half the country is on one side and half of the country is on the other. I think, you know, we're talking about 43% of people who back Trump, then, you know, we can look at the numbers of people who actually voted for Trump. We can look at the 100 million people who didn't participate in the last election, who were never counted in anything and who trend towards being younger, more of color, who would be classified as Democrats in a classical way. And so I think that part of the issue that we have is that there is such a myopia with Donald Trump that every sentence, every breath, everything that he does absorbs the entirety of public attention, partly because of the mainstream media. But I think in doing so, it really minimizes the extent of opposition that exists in the country, not just to him, but to what is happening in this country, where there are all sorts of organizing movements of demonstrations, of things that continue to percolate just below the surface, whether it's teachers who are mobilizing to protect themselves from the dangers of COVID, as government officials try to force them back into school buildings, the ongoing struggle around the rights of immigrants in this country. You know, just 10 days ago, the lead story was about the forced sterilization of immigrants in detention, immigrant women in detention in Georgia. And Trump says boo, and we move on to the next thing, as if that is not a story that is deserving of deeper investigation. There is the ongoing struggle around climate. Obviously, the ongoing movement around Black lives and the struggle against police brutality, the struggle around housing, the struggles around healthcare. There are all of these things that are the kind of disparate parts of a mass movement that has the potential to develop in this country. That is constantly overshadowed.
I would agree with you. I would agree with you on all of that, and I would agree with you that there's a majority of Americans who want progressive change. But again, I get back to this 40% of Americans. That 40% has maybe five times as many guns, and a much more sort of at this point core of people who are willing to resort to violence to impose their will. And my question is, how does the progressive movement deal with that?
Well, I think part of the point that I was making is that we have the parts of a mass movement. What we need are the politics to try to connect these disparate parts together. We need organizations, not just little organizations working on their own, but we need organizations that reflect the potential of the mass movement that I think is in development. I mean, the right has always had more guns at their disposal. Our side, the left, the majority of people who suffer from oppression and exploitation in this country and other countries have never had the guns to force our agenda onto anyone. We've always had the mass of our movement as that which is the vehicle for social transformation. And I don't think that any of that has changed. And I think part of the issue is that there's a way in which the over hyper focus on every single thing that Trump does and says magnifies his mesmerizing abilities. It creates an impression that he's popular when he's not. It creates an impression that the forces gathered around him are more massive when they're not. I thought it was interesting that the Proud Boys were supposed to have a mass turnout in Portland, Oregon, where thousands of people were predicted to show up, and only 200 did. And so that is not, 200 is 200 and shouldn't be taken lightly, but it's also not indicative of a mass movement. And I think in every place where there has been predictions of some mass outpouring of the right, the actual reality has been underwhelming. And we compare that to what the New York Times reported in June or July in the aftermath of 15 to 26 million people participating in Black Lives Matter protests, the largest number of participants in in political protests in American history. And we look at the number of gatherings that have happened over the course of the Trump presidency. And I think it's clear that the other side, that our side, has millions of people who are looking for some direction, who are looking for a political alternative to the status quo as it exists right now. And so the challenge is, how do you unite the different aspects of that, the different segments of that, both in protest, in organization? How do you develop solidarity? All of these questions are the challenges that we face.
Professor Kangiamata Teller, we have to break, then we're going to come back. Sure. We're going to link to your latest piece, The Case for Ending the Supreme Court as We Know It. Also, Democracy Now! Is live streaming the first presidential debate tonight, 9 Eastern Standard Time at democracynow.org. When we come back, we're going to look with Professor Kangiamata Teller at the Breonna Taylor case and also what's happening in her city, in Philadelphia. Unhoused people rise up, demanding and getting some housing. Stay with us. Jill Scott. This is Democracy Now!, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Less than a week after a grand jury failed to charge the police officers who shot Breonna Taylor with her death, a judge has ordered Kentucky's Attorney General Daniel Cameron to release the recording of the grand jury proceedings to the court. Not yet clear whether the tape will be made public. On Monday, an anonymous grand juror sued in order to unseal the court transcripts, accusing Cameron of using the grand jury, quote, as a shield to deflect accountability and responsibility for those decisions. The juror also said jury members should be granted the right to speak freely about the case and be allowed to share, quote, any potential charges and defendants presented or not presented. The grand jury's only indictments were 3 counts of wanton endangerment against former Louisville police detective Brett Hankison for shooting into the apartment of a neighbor. The 2 officers who shot Breonna Taylor 6 times on March 13th were not charged after the grand grand jury deemed their actions justified. On Monday, Brett Hankison pleaded not guilty to the three counts of wanton endangerment. This all comes as Vice News interviews with Louisville SWAT team members have revealed that concerns about the deadly raid that killed Breonna Taylor were raised both before and after it happened. Still with us, historian Kianga Yamada Taylor in Philadelphia, contributing writer to The New Yorker, professor at Princeton University. You've been writing a lot, tweeting a lot about the Breonna Taylor case. The decision came down from the grand jury. Clearly, the grand jury is upset, saying they were only presented with wanton endangerment, and none of these three officers were charged with Breonna Taylor's death. Your comments.
Well, I think that there are a couple of things. One is that it's clear a grand jury is a very kind of just a procedural formality, and the fact that this took over 2 days and it appears as if it was rigged in such a way as to not raise the question of murder or manslaughter. But to advance as weak charges as possible. And so the fact that the proceedings may have to be publicized, as you said at the top, it's not clear if the recordings will be made public. But I think that it speaks to two things. One is that it's important to remember that without the protest movement that exploded around the death of the killing of George Floyd at the end of May, that nothing would have been done in this case. Breonna Taylor was shot and killed on March 13th. And the second thing, which I think is really important, is that this kind of case really contributes to what I think is an unfolding dynamic of radicalization in the United States. And what I mean is that for millions of people, I don't think thousands, I think millions of people who have been watching this case across the country and indeed across the world, to have it go through the quote-unquote proper channels and still come out with a rigged decision raises existential questions for people about the legitimacy of the institutions of governance in the United States, certainly in Kentucky, but in the country at large, because it maps on to those same questions being asked of other institutions. Again, we're told that the Supreme Court is not a political body when we are watching in real time it being used in the most grotesque political ways. We are told that the criminal justice system is blind to black and white, it's colorblind. And then here we can see where it is functioning fully color conscious. And so I think for millions of people in this country, people who have participated in demonstrations against police brutality, it raises fundamental questions about what is happening in the United States, where even when you do what you are supposed to do and a case goes through the course that it is supposed to go through, an investigation goes through the channels that it is supposed to, and it still produces a completely corrupted, unjust decision, raises questions about the legitimacy of all of the institutions that are involved in this. And then people begin to come to their own conclusions about what needs to change and what that change should look like as a result. So I think that this decision is extremely consequential in the U.S. right now.
Kianga, you're in Philadelphia. Your book, Race for Profit, How Banks and the Real Estate Industry Undermine Black Home Ownership, was a 2020 finalist for the Pulitzer Prize for History. Congratulations. But I want to ask you about the historic victory in Philadelphia among housing activists after city officials agreed Friday to hand over 50 vacant homes to a community land trust following months of organizing by unhoused people, including protests, encampments, and taking over vacant homes. 50 mothers and children who've been occupying 15 vacant city-owned houses will also be permitted to stay as part of the deal. Philadelphia Housing Action, the group behind the Direct Action campaign, will set up the Community Land Trust. On Monday, we reached community organizer Jen Benich at the Camp Teddy encampment and asked her to describe the significance of the victory.
Not just is it like a win for us, and not just is it a win even for the people in the encampments who will be able to move into homes, but this is also like 50 units that would have been sold to developers and used to speed up the process of gentrification in our neighborhoods. We're going to be able to like house people from the encampment if everything goes through right, and also we'll be stopping these units from being sold off to the private market and potentially becoming like luxury condos or student housing in our neighborhoods. If this works out, then it could be a good place to go and say like that instead of allowing housing authorities to like sell units and make money off of them after they intentionally neglected them until they were too much for them to deal with, then allow community groups to take on those units and rehab them and use them for what their original use was, which is to house people in need.
So that's housing organizer Jen Benich. If you can talk about the significance of this victory and just in the bigger picture, we're talking about tens of millions of Americans face eviction. This is a key area that you focus on, Kianga Yamada Taylor.
Sure. I think this is tremendously significant. Not only is this a vindication of a strategy that was focused on direct action. People occupied, you know, Tony sections of downtown Philadelphia. They refused to move. They acted in solidarity with each other. There are so many times over the last 2 months when the city threatened to shut down the camps, when the city threatened legal action against the organizers. And throughout that, people stood tall. They did not cave into the pressure, and they essentially called the city's bluff. And the city was reluctant to actually move in on the camp because Philadelphia has been a site of very large demonstrative protests around police brutality. There's a well-organized legal protection as well as activist networks in the city that I think created some pause and reluctance on the part of city officials. But I think even beyond its impact in Philadelphia, which I think is tremendous, there's a bigger lesson to be drawn here because this dynamic exists all over the country where you have both empty housing and houseless people, a completely irrational expression of what American capitalism means. But even more perniciously, you have public housing authorities. Every city has one, which is either sitting on properties that they should be distributing to people in need of housing, but they are sitting on properties waiting for the right price point to flip those properties for profit. And that is unconscionable for public housing authorities to be engaged in that kind of predatory gentrifying behavior. And so what has happened here in Philadelphia is creating a model for what all tenant organizing and activist groups should be taking up, which is occupy the space, occupy the properties, and put pressure, political pressure, on public housing authorities to do their job and house people who are unhoused. It is not that complicated. We shouldn't be having empty housing and people without homes in the midst of a pandemic. At no time should we be having it, but we certainly should not be experiencing this in the midst of a pandemic. And I think that this is a model, a strategic model, and a tactic that should be generalized by housing groups across the country. Now is the time, I think, to move on this, because the emergency of housing insecurity is at its most acute point. But also, there's a greater connection being made between housing as healthcare, housing as a right, that has been demonstrated by the CDC's own moratorium against evictions, which really demonstrate that housing is an issue of health care as well as an issue of shelter.
Kianga Yamada-Teller, we want to thank you so much for being with us. New Yorker writer, author of Race for Profit, How Banks and the Real Estate Industry Undermine Black Home Ownership, 2020 finalist for the Pulitzer Prize, and author of From Black Lives Matter to Black Liberation, assistant professor of African American Studies at Princeton University. Next up, Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter David K. Johnston on the bombshell report that President Trump did not pay any federal income tax in 10 of the past 15 years. Trump not only faces the election and possible defeat, could he face jail time for tax fraud? Stay with us. By the OJs. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. When President Trump and Joe Biden meet tonight for their first of three presidential debates, and you can watch it here at democracynow.org at 9 Eastern Standard, Trump is expected to face questions about the bombshell report in the New York Times that revealed he paid no federal income tax in 10 of the past 15 years and just $750 in 2016 and 17. In a follow-up report, the Times reveals Trump made $427 million off the hit reality TV show The Apprentice, providing him a financial lifeline as other investments lost money. The Times reports, quote, Mr. Trump's genius, it turned out, wasn't running a company. It was making himself famous, Trump-scale famous, and monetizing that fame, unquote. Well, the Biden campaign responded quickly on Sunday to the New York Times expose with a video ad showing the typical income taxes paid by workers compared to Trump. Teachers paid $7,239. Firefighters paid $5,283. Nurses paid, $10,216. Donald Trump paid $750 while boasting he's a billionaire. The Times reports also detailed Trump's questionable write-offs and tax filings from major business losses and massive debts, including more than $300 million in loans that'll come due in the next 4 years. The revelations have raised national security concerns, with Democratic Senator Elizabeth Warren saying, quote, he may be vulnerable to financial blackmail from a hostile foreign power, and God knows what else. He paid more in taxes to the Philippines and India than he did to the United States. For more, we're joined by David K. Johnston, Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative reporter who has reported extensively on Donald Trump and his taxes for more than 30 years. Previously, he worked with The New York Times, now co-founder and editor of DCReport.org. His most recent book, It's Even Worse Than You Think, What the Trump Administration is Doing to America. So you have written, David K. Johnston, I think there's lots of evidence that Donald Trump is a criminal-level tax cheat. Is this true, you think, if he were not reelected, he could go to jail on these charges?
Well, whether he goes to jail is ultimately the decision of a judge after a trial and conviction. Does he deserve to go to jail? Oh, absolutely. But on the federal level in this country, where we have about 155 million tax returns filed each year, we only prosecute about 1,200 people, and most of those are drug dealers or politicians who took bribes. There is no serious effort in the United States to prosecute tax criminals. In fact, the IRS is aware of more than a half million people who made a high income did not even file a tax return in 2014, 15, or 16, And they're not even trying to pursue them because they have no money. The Congress has cut and cut the IRS. In just the last 10 years, they've gotten rid of one-third of the auditors. If you make $1 million or more, we have people in America, Amy, who make several billion dollars a year, your odds of being audited are less than 3 in 100.
And David, I wanted to ask you about the Times piece, not only yesterday, but today as well, because there's a lot of new information in there, especially there was this mention of this $72 million tax refund that Trump claimed in the few years that he actually did pay taxes. He then apparently got a refund because he was claiming, I guess, carryovers of previous losses to get that money back. Could you explain this whole issue of capital gains and how ultra wealthy people use losses in future years to not pay taxes?
Well, corporations, but not individuals, are allowed to smooth out their income for tax purposes. So if a business makes a profit, say, in 7 years and loses money in three, they get to use the three losing years to offset their profits from the others. Trump did something different. When I got Donald's 2005 income tax return, he only paid $3 million of regular income tax on an income of over $150 million. He paid a lower rate than the poorest half of American taxpayers who that year made, on average, $16,000. But he did pay another $35 million of what's called alternative minimum tax. And for real estate developers, that's not really a tax. What happens is the accounting rules cause you to pay the tax 1 year, and then the government gives it back to you in future years if you stay in the real estate business. Essentially, the government takes from you a zero interest loan for a year. Now, Trump's refund of $72 million plus is supposed to be held back until it is reviewed by the staff of the Congressional Joint Committee on Taxation. Any refund of more than $2 million is supposed to be reviewed first by the Joint Committee. Trump got the refund. He got the check. It's not clear if there was a mistake made here or the Joint Committee passed on it. If they did, it's probably because it was seen as an alternative minimum tax refund. But Donald's claim, you know, that he pays a lot of taxes is based on not really paying taxes. It's based on this system in which real estate developers may end up loaning the government money for a year or two at zero interest. That's not a tax.
And I wanted to ask you about in today's article, the Times section is kind of buried deep in the story, but it does begin to point at what could be a possible Russia connection. And in addition to the Miss Universe contest that they talked about yesterday, this Bayrock group that actually rented offices right below the Trump offices in the Trump Tower, and that financed a huge amount of the foreign ventures of the Trump organization. Could you talk about them? Because they were basically being run by Russian oligarchs.
Right. I've written a lot about this, and interestingly, Dutch television, I think it's pronounced Zembla, has done really excellent work about this. Donald Trump has long been connected with mobsters of all kinds, not just New York City mafioso, but all sorts, particularly of Russian-speaking mobsters. And he had in his office a convicted violent felon who worked for him named Felix Sater. Trump has said, I wouldn't recognize him if I was in the room. I've got photo and video of them traveling all over the country and doing deals, none of which worked out together, and some of which appear to be scams. Trump has very deep financial connections to the Russian oligarchs, who are essentially a criminal gang. And this is the area of national security that should most worry Americans about Donald Trump. The pageant, the only beauty pageant, remember, Donald has boasted about how he had the right to walk in on half-naked teenage girls at his beauty pageants because he owned them. That's what kind of creep he is. The only one of his beauty pageants that made money was the 2013 pageant in Moscow. Well, was it really a profit they made, or was it Vladimir Putin or one of his agents putting money in Donald's pocket in order to curry favor with him? I remember Donald has never said a single negative word about Vladimir Putin. In fact, he has said, I trust Vladimir Putin, but I don't trust the American intelligence agencies.
You know, the time...
There's a lot more. I'm sorry.
The Times did find, they made the point that the tax documents do not reveal any previously unreported connections to Russia. However, they talk about the amount of money he paid to the Philippines, the amount of money he paid to India. And then the larger point that a number of people have raised is, does this make him a national security risk? If these loans are going to come due, these debts of over $400 million, what's he going to do to deal with this? And did he sign off on laws as president that benefit him personally?
Well, let's deal with the forthcoming loans. It's very clear from the Times reporting that Donald does not have the resources to pay back more than $300 million of loans he personally guaranteed. Now, if you are an actual billionaire, which Donald has never been, and you own valuable assets, you don't have to personally guarantee a loan. You just pledge the assets as collateral. So that's the first thing that tells you that Donald is not, and as I've reported as far back as 1990, never has been a billionaire. It's just a fraud, a hoax by him. The loans would come due during a second Trump term. Well, the resolution of that's, I think, pretty obvious. Donald Trump appoints the banking regulators in the United States. He controls the banking regulation system. You think any bank licensed by the government is going to foreclose on the president of the United States? No, they're going to give him what's called a forbearance. Well, we'll extend the terms of your loan, sir. Perhaps you'd like a holiday on your payments. Could we lower the interest rate for you, sir? Please, what could we do as bankers?
You said that one of the crucial but unstated messages from this report on Trump's taxes is that Americans are, quote, chumps when it comes to our own income taxes. Could you expand on that?
Well, I've been trying to get Americans to understand that what happened starting with the Reagan administration and the end of the New Deal is that America devised two income tax systems, separate and unequal. Those of us who are workers or pensioners, as I am, our taxes are withheld before we get our money. The government knows how much money we got. The Trump tax law eliminated itemizing of deductions. Only one in 20 taxpayers now is going to do that, and they're almost all going to be very rich. You can't get a deduction for a charitable gift or a home mortgage or state and local taxes anymore in 95 out of 100 households. But people who own their own business, like Donald Trump, they are under a different system. Congress doesn't trust us. That's why it takes the taxes out first. But Congress trusts Donald Trump and everyone like him that they will fully and faithfully report the actual income they had, and then they will pay all the taxes that they owe. And the only check on that are audits. So what has Congress been doing in particularly the George W. Bush administration, the Reagan administration, well, a little bit in the Reagan administration, and under Donald Trump? Well, they've been getting rid of auditors so that your odds, if you're a million-dollar plus income person, of being audited, as I said, are less than 3% a year. And even then, the IRS is so badly underfunded and understaffed that at DC Report, we did a five-part story last year about the third Koch brother, Bill Koch, who is getting $100 million a year and paying no income taxes through a device that I think is clearly improper, arguably criminal. We proved with the documents he was under criminal investigation. He's the only Koch brother who supports Donald Trump. And a couple of weeks after Donald Trump became president, his next-door neighbor at Mar-a-Lago, Bill Koch's criminal investigation suddenly stopped.
Finally, David K. Johnston, the first presidential debate is tonight. What question do you want to see raised about Donald Trump's taxes?
Oh, I think the biggest mistake Joe Biden could make would be to somehow attack wealth. That just doesn't sell in America. I think that what he should do is press him on, all right, the cat's out of the bag. You say it's fake news. Just show us your Form 1040s back to the year 2000. Why don't you just put out your Form 1040s? One of them's out. David K. Johnston published it 3 years ago. Just show those, and we'll see whether it's fake news or not. And Donald will dodge and parry about that. The emails I'm getting from people on the right are all designed to tell you that Joe Biden is a secret crook with a billion-dollar fortune All of which is utter nonsense, by the way. This is a man who hadn't paid off his mortgage.
Well, David K. Johnston, I want to thank you for being with us, Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative reporter, editor of DCReport.org. In his most recent book, It's Even Worse Than You Think, What the Trump Administration is Doing to America. Tonight, we will be streaming the first presidential debate live, 9 Eastern Standard Time at democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Thanks so much for joining us. Stay safe. Wear a mask.